Okay, my name is Gor Nishanov. I am a developer with Microsoft Visual C++ team, and I work on the design, standardization, and help with the implementation of stackless resumable functions, most efficient, most scalable, most open coroutines of any programming language in existence. And if you don't believe me at the end of the presentation, please let me know. So resumable functions, they went a long way. So initial proposal was in 2012. It was kind of stuck and didn't go anywhere for 2 years. And then we did a refocus last year where we focused on the efficiency and customizability. And that seemed to help because we got an approval of the direction last October. And just last week, the latest revision, number 4, was accepted by evolution group and was sent to core for wordsmithing. And if we're lucky, it can get into C++ 17. And there are many people who contributed to that, and I am not listing all of them here. Now, we have experimental implementation with a stress on experimental in Microsoft Visual C++. First version was released in preview. Then we had another just a month ago, release candidate. And there were more iterations every time, trying to target the constantly changing the actual proposal. And there is a Clang implementation in progress, and there is an implementation in EDG front-end. And for the latest papers, you can go and look them up. The first one is an overview, and the second one is actual standard wording. And some people may find wording more readable. Some might prefer the other one. So coroutines are popular because now we can see that in a whole bunch of languages. I mean, Python got the similar style coroutines just a few weeks ago. We have Hack, we have Dart 1.9, we have C# for a pretty long time, and we might have a similar syntax in C++. So what makes C++ coroutines unique and set them apart from the coroutines in any other language? Well, there is a set of goals we set to guide the design of the coroutines. And one of the goals was that they have to be very scalable. So it's not just, you know, 1,000 coroutines or 100,000. No, we're talking 100 millions. And I would have put billion there if only I had more memory on this laptop, because that's essentially how much I can do it on this laptop. Second one, they have to be efficient. The overhead of a suspend and resume should be equivalent to the overhead of a function call. So that means you should not think twice whether to use the function or to use the coroutine. If a particular problem is easier to be solved using the coroutine, go ahead, use it. Moreover, we wanted to make sure that coroutines can interact seamlessly with the rest of the world. So on the outside, coroutine is just a normal function. You can put it into a std function, you can pass it as a callback to somebody, you can stick extern C on it so that it can be consumed by the C interface. And on the inside of the function, again, there is no restrictions on what you can do. Okay, one correction. You cannot set jump, you cannot long jump essentially out of it and inside, but apart from that, you can do pretty much whatever you want. And in addition, we wanted to make sure that you can marshal the coroutine across C boundary. So if you have a particular interface like in OS or some library, you can actually make a suspended coroutine, a handle to a coroutine, convert to a void star, pass it as a context to your C API, and then when you receive a callback from OS or from some C library, you can reconstitute the coroutine back from that void star handle and resume it. Now, coroutine machinery is it's a complicated change in the compiler. And we did not want to tie it to a particular task library. You just heard in the previous talk that std future are not very good. And you know, maybe there will be better ones in the future. So we did not want to tie coroutines to any particular kind of std future. We wanted them to be open, so you can adapt them to existing asynchronous facility or to the one that will appear in the future. And you can invent new coroutine types in addition to having just generators, tasks, and you can do more. And finally, because again, it's a major investment in the compiler, we wanted not to limit it, not to tie it to exceptions in such a way that you cannot use them, say, in the kernel mode or in companies where for some reason exceptions are banned. So those are the set of goals we set, and of course the proposal we have satisfies all of those. So, and this is just a summary of what we have in the proposal. So we're getting two new keywords, await and yield. We will have two new concepts, awaitable and coroutine promise. And finally, two concrete types in the library. Now, with regard to the keywords, essentially those were the keywords for the last 3 years, but last week in the standardization committee, we had some discussion. So those keywords might change. So I will talk about that closer to the end of the talk. Okay, what are coroutines? Coroutines are very, very old. First mentioned 1958, that is 57 years ago. Who have heard about Conway's law? Whoa, okay, well, I will restate it because I also just learned about it very recently. And the law in its less general form states that if four teams are trying to implement a compiler, you will end up with a compiler with four passes. And back then, passes were pretty expensive. You would read your input from the punch tape, you will churn and then put an output of the pass on the tape again, then you load the tape for the next pass and keep going. It wastes a lot of paper. And Conway was concerned about wasting paper. What he wanted to be able to still write your passes in the same way that you would do before, where you would read some value from the input, churn on it a little bit, and then put them in the output. But instead of writing to a tape, he wanted to suspend this path at the point where it would yield the result or write something into the tape, and instead resume the second pass at the point where it would read from the tape. And the definition he gave for the coroutine was something like that. Coroutine is a function that acts like a main program. It's a little bit vague. So about 10 years later, Knuth gave more workable definition where coroutine is a generalization of a function. And with this, we can work. So essentially, a function, it has two operations, a call and return. In a call, we pass an arguments, then the function works on those arguments, producing side effects, and eventually, or not if you are pure, of course, and eventually you will return the result, and at that point, the frame, activation frame of the function will disappear. Now, coroutine will have both of those operations slightly tweaked, and in addition, it will acquire two more, suspend and resume. Coroutines come in many flavors. So one of it is, distinction between coroutines is symmetric or asymmetric. In symmetric coroutines, the act of suspension is glued together with resumption. You cannot just suspend the coroutine. You must at the same time resume another coroutine. So it acts more like a context switch where I say, suspend me and resume Bob. You cannot separate those operations. Where we have an example of coroutines of that kind in Modula 2, Win32 fibers act in this manner, and boost context also behave like that. And asymmetric coroutines, suspension and resumption are distinct. When you resume an asynchronous coroutine, it returns back to the caller, and then there is some handle that can be used later to resume the coroutine. And initially, people believed that symmetric coroutines are more powerful than asymmetric ones. But later, it was shown that one can be implemented in terms of another, so they're equivalent. So the choice between those two, essentially, it's whatever fits better the environment in which you are using the coroutines. Another one is whether coroutines are full class objects that you can return from a function, you know, store in a variable, or it's some syntactic artifact that only can appear, you know, in this lexical scope. So the good ones, of course, are first class. So we'll not even go for the constraint one. And finally, another distinction is how much state coroutine has to preserve when it suspends. With stackful coroutines, it must preserve entire stack. Whereas in stackless coroutine, you preserve just the frame of the function which is being suspended. So usually, coroutines are paired in this fashion. So if you have symmetric, first class, and stackful, well, there is a better name probably for that. Those are user mode schedule threads, user mode threads fibers. It's essentially when you are able to replace entire user mode stack and switch it off and put another one in. The benefit of the stackful coroutines is that you essentially don't change your code. You write it the same way you write it for threads, and then there is an ability to swap one stack for another. Where with stackless coroutines, if you combine asymmetric, first class, stackless, is what we are proposing for C++ 17. Now, stackful coroutines come with a cost. So when you are trying to call suspend in a function, so this little green box, so, well, square, no, something, a box, let's call it a box. Essentially, this is the state of the function that you want to suspend. It has local parameters and locals and parameters. But you cannot just suspend that function. You also need to suspend the function before that, and essentially you suspend entire call stack, which starts with main or some thread start routine. And they're expensive because the user mode stack still consumes a lot of memory. You can try to mitigate that like HPX is doing, where your default stack is very small, for example, 8K. But that put limitations on what you can do in a coroutine. So you cannot call functions that might consume more than 8K. So attempt to mitigate that is, for example, you modify your prologue and epilogue, and you have non-contiguous stack, where you allocate your stack in little chunks. First, you got 4K, and then every function would check, do I have enough? If not, it will allocate more somewhere on the side and then links them together. Now, this takes care of the problem that you cannot call call things that need more stack than your initial default one. But it has a different problem, is that now you are sandbox. You cannot call out of your sandbox that understand how to do chain stacks. So if your OS does not support chain stacks, you cannot really call an OS API without doing some stack swapping. Whereas in a stackless coroutine, that is essentially everything that needs to be saved. Also, even though I say stackless, stackless coroutines do use stack. But they only use the stack for the things that don't have to be persisted across suspend and resume. Because I mentioned before, asymmetric coroutines look like a function to the outside world, so they will still follow the normal ABI for the function. You will pass parameters sometimes on the stack, and then there is a return value. It all will be on the stack. But then when we suspend, stack gets turned down, but the little bit of coroutine state is preserved. And later, it can be used when we resume the coroutine. So these are coroutines in general. What are coroutines in C++?
Question on the stack
list. Sure.
Does that mean you can't pass by reference then if the rest of your stack got destroyed?
You can pass by reference, yes. The question is, can you pass things to a coroutine by reference? Yes, absolutely. You can pass things to coroutine by reference, but you need to be careful with the lifetime of those things. So if you have a local variable in your function, and then you call a coroutine and you pass an address of that variable, well, coroutine will persist potentially beyond the lifetime of your stack, so that will be bad. But there are very valid there are valid cases where you would want to pass stuff to a coroutine by reference, and I will have a few examples of that. Okay. Coroutines in C++, before we had the general discussion. So, is Nika here? No. Well, essentially, I'm not afraid to put standard D's right in the slides, because it's beautiful text. What it says is coroutine is a function which has suspension points that are introduced by await and yield. And moreover, it clarifies that it is just a function from the outside. Nobody can know that it's a coroutine. Coroutine is just an implementation detail of the function. And this is a hello world coroutine style. So from the main perspective, what I'm doing here, I'm just calling hello. And hello would return me some iterable that has begin and end. And range base 4 will start pulling values from the iterators that were provided, and it will get those characters and start printing them up. So everything looks normal. If we look at the implementation here, we see that essentially coroutine starts executing, it hits yield, it gives control back to the main. Main consumes the yielded character. Then when the range based 4 pulls the next value from the iterator, it resumes the coroutine at this point, and it keeps going. And I will have more detailed explanation how it works. This is just a quick overview. Now, because coroutine is a normal function, it can also be a member function. And thus, it can be a member function operator call of a closure object. So we can have a coroutine lambda. So again, hello world coroutine style. This is the lambda, which uses yield. We store it in hello. Now I call the lambda. It gives me back an iterable. And I'll start working, pulling values out of it. So these are examples of how you can use yield. Now this is a very silly example of how you can use await. So in this case, I'm launching this coroutine. And I'm awaiting on an asynchronous operation called sleep 4. And we will see an example how it is implemented later. So here, coroutine is suspended. At this point, control goes back to main. And main just blocks, waiting for the future to get ready. When the timer fires, coroutine is resumed at this point, continues, and eventually returns value 42. And this is what will be printed out in main after that. So those were just a couple of silly examples. But when would you want to use coroutine for real? Well, it usually is when you want a state machine. But it is easier to implement the state machine in imperative style, using control flow of a function, as opposed to as an actual state machine. And one example was inspired by Eric's talk from yesterday, which was an interleave. So here, what I want to do, I want to, and the problem essentially was write a range adapter that will take a range of ranges, and then it will produce a single sequence where values from those ranges that were given to it are interleaved. So essentially, I want to print something like that. We will go 1, 10, 100, 220, 2000, sorry, 200. Etc. Until we exhaust all of the values in the sequence, or you know, it could be an infinite sequence, and then we will just keep producing those interleaved values. So let's write it as a coroutine, and as the first step, let's just write it as a normal function where we will print what we want to get essentially yielded to the standard output. So let's go. Interleave will take a range of ranges. And I would copy it into a vector. And type T will be deduced something like that. Whatever is, you know, the reference at begin, and then I will strip the reference from it. Now, let's start a loop. And the loop will, in this empty space, will go through all of the ranges and tries to pull a value from a range and then output it, you know, print it out. And we will count how many of those we did in this empty space. If we didn't yield a single value, it means that essentially all ranges are empty and we need to bail out. So the body will look like this. We will start going over all of the ranges in that array. We will see if we have something to pull. And here I am doing something. I apologize. I couldn't use your library because I'm running the compiler, which cannot, you know, compile ranges. I quickly hack it up, and this is one of the hacks. I need a quick way to pull something from a range and essentially drop the first value. It was plus plus. And then after I print it out, I will count how many values were yielded. And essentially, this is it. This is our first attempt of doing interleave. But first, we are doing it as a regular function. OK. Get ready for a magic. 1, 2, 3. Done. So now, this is a coroutine. Notice this empty space. Because I was waiting for the question. Yeah, essentially, the trick I did to minimize number of changes, in this case, the result is void. And in this case, the result will be a generator of whatever is being yielded. And it's just too long to type whatever is being yielded, so I just substitute that with some English prose. Any questions at this point? Yes? Oh, absolutely. Okay. But some people would prefer to actually see that it's a generator as opposed to going through the body and trying to figure it out. But for templates that are very generic, it could get messy. So auto actually helps. Oh, sorry. The question was, you don't have to write the return type. And the answer is yes, of course. But some people prefer to do so, and I'm showing it here. Yes? So if we are auto-deducing the return type, we have essentially default generator type, default task type. So if you're using yields, then we're saying, OK, it will be a default generator. And generator of what will be deduced from whatever we are yielding. And it's the same rules as for return, essentially. We will go and deduce every yield statement. And then if they produce a different type, that's a compile time error. If it's the same, we will happily generate generator of whatever. If we're using weight and we're using auto type deduction, there is a default task. But this is for the library group. I don't want that thing to be future. I hope the default one to be some good task type which doesn't exist yet. So I would actually would like to just get the compiler support for that and possibly a generator because it's very uncontroversial and very efficient. And then let this language facility to be sometime in the wild so that we can maybe with the Sean's task or some other good default task library. And then there is a combination of await and yield, which gives even funnier monster, which is like a synchronous stream, like in reactive functional programming. Again, we don't have an actual type proposal for that, but we know that it will appear in the future. Yes?
So it looks to me that you have two different return types. Return types. You yield a value, and later on you return nothing.
Good question. Remember the table I put in the beginning about how coroutines and functions are similar. Because we're talking about asymmetric coroutines, we have two perspectives. From perspective of the caller, coroutine returns back the control back to the caller on the first suspend. Whereas from the perspective of the coroutine, it didn't actually return. It's right here. It's just temporarily suspended. So you need to put those two different mindsets. If you're on the outside, you don't even know that it's a coroutine. You just called it, you got something back, and then you work with that. When you're looking at the body, your essentially perspective here, oh, I'm just executing, and I suspend it here in the same essentially manner as if I called a function. The standard, if you go and read like the section one something, says that like the function is suspended when it calls a different function. So imagine that yield simply a call to a function that will suspend you. But we are still in the middle of it. Eventually, when we keep going and when we reach the end, or we'll hit the return, it's an indication that we are done. So that is when coroutine is actually destroyed.
It just looks strange because you have a return value, but then you don't.
Absolutely. Yes, so the question is, it is kind of weird that we have yield and return, and the answer is yes. But surprisingly, in a lot of other languages, people, you know, accepted that semantic. And one intuitive explanation, as I gave here, is that, well, you are not actually returning here from perspective of this function. This function is in the middle of the execution. It's just suspended right here. It will keep going. So then, from perspective of inside of the function, this is a return, which means, you know, I am done. I either provide a value, but in any case, I want to destroy, you know, my frame, and I'm done. So, but suspension in the asynchronous coroutine is observed like a return with the meaning of transfer of control back to the caller. So those two operations are distinct in asymmetric coroutines. Alistair.
You might want to mention the suggested renaming from the Lenexa meeting.
I have slides. Yeah, I have slides at the end about that.
The specific slide here is where this cleaned up a lot for me, which is why I suggested now.
Yes, and I will have those slides. It's about slide number 58 or 57, and we will get to it. The question was, should we start talking about the renaming those keywords that was suggested last week? And I say, sure, but let's do that slightly later. Sorry.
It's the same follow-up question. The return type of the generator, whatever, that goes with the yield or the return. I mean, it doesn't. There is no return. You're not returning anything, right?
So function has a return statement that returns nothing.
Function is
a
yes.
File, whereas you have a return type.
Yes. So the question is, it is still confusing that we have a return type here, but this type is not the same one as being returned here. It's a property of asymmetric coroutines that there are two different kind of returns. One is a suspend, and another is actually when the function is done. And yes?
I'm going to ask the same question in a different way. So you've explained from within this function how yield and return look different. From the calling function, I understand when this coroutine yields, then it gets back the value. From the calling function, what does it see when this coroutine returns?
So when the the coroutine completes, right, here. In the case of the generator, it essentially means that your iterator will compare to the end, and thus you don't need to consume anything anymore. If it would be a future, then return returns the eventual result. So this is the point where you would call .get and get the result back. Yes. Yes.
The signature of this function, the return type, is generated.
Yes.
Void.
Yes.
Okay. But it's okay to return within the function nothing.
Yes, and it will be a compile time error if you return here something else. Yes.
What happens if the user of the generator doesn't consume everything that the generator has?
When the destructor of the generator runs, at this point, it will destroy all of the objects which are alive and run their destructors and eventually deallocate the frame. The question was, what happens if the guy who consumes the coroutine only, you know, consume couple of values and then drop it on the floor? Well, the answer is, in this case, coroutine is destroyed when the generator destructor runs, and whatever has to be correctly, whatever destructors has to run, as if exception is thrown at this point, would run. However, we did not tie exceptions to coroutines. It will be a different mechanism, but it will do the same effect. Yes. And I sorry. Over there.
Is generator a standard library type?
It will be. It's not part of the proposal. It is. But the question is generator is a library type? So currently, it is shown as an example in the proposal. It is. It doesn't have yet official wording, but I think it makes sense to actually add it because it's very uncontroversial in terms of it. It's a simple thing, at relatively efficient. Unlike future, where people have different opinions of whether it's good or bad. Let's do the interleaving.
What happens if the argument RG range is empty?
Well, let's see. Maybe they have a bug. So the question is, what happens if the argument RG is empty? So essentially, it's a range of ranges which has no ranges in it. Let's see. So the vector of ranges will be of zero size, right? And then here, we will make values yielded to equal to zero. This loop will not execute at all. And we go here, and we bail out. Okay. Next example. So we saw when it might make sense to use a coroutine. One thing I want to mention is that coroutines of generator type, they give you input iterators. You cannot go back. They're not forward iterators. So they only give you an input iterator abstraction. Well, another way where you would want to use a coroutine, if you want to go from asynchronous code to asynchronous code. So this is our initial function from which we'll make in the coroutine on the next slide. What we're doing here, we're getting a parameter which says how many bytes we need to read from some TCP connection. We will connect to a socket. We will start reading bytes from that socket in the chunks of 64K. Then we will count how many of those bytes contain letter C. And then we will return it. Let's make it a coroutine. So just for fun, in how many lines do I have to change the code to make it a coroutine? One line. Can I get two?
Two,
okay. Can I get three? Four? So two, right? Okay. Three. Let's see. One, two, three. Aha! It is three. Because in this case, I was showing that showing the return type. So we started with await. Every time where we would want to call an asynchronous function and then suspend the coroutine awaiting for the result of a synchronous function, we would suspend here. And eventually, when we're done computing, we will return the result. And because it is now a coroutine, the return type must represent an idea of eventual value that is not available immediately. And future is one of those types. Again, this proposal does not tie coroutines to std future, but since we have them, we can use them in that fashion. Yes?
So the only difference between a future and a generator is a future by definition only yields one value?
Well, the question is, the difference between the future and generator is that future yields one value and generator yields multiple values. There are several ways of trying to generalize the future. So. One way to think about it, and that's how it is done in reactive streams, is that so you have this thing that produces a sequence of values. And then it is followed by the termination or an exception. So in one sense, you can view the future is the thing which doesn't yield anything, and the only thing it provides the termination signal that I am done, and this is the result, or this is an exception. And it doesn't have any intermediate values. Or another way to look at it is that, well, it is a sequence which yields exactly one value. You could view it this way. Are we good? Yes. Well, this is not exactly infinite, right? At some point, we will read enough bytes so that... But if it were infinite, then the poor guy which waits for the result will call .get, and it will never get it. And before I showed traditional coroutines, but this proposal does not limit ourselves to just, you know, tasks and generators. So... there is this language, Go. Who have used it? Oh, good. So you will keep me honest when I try to explain that. So language Go wanted to solve concurrency problems by providing lightweight coroutines that they called goroutines. And how you would work with them, you would combine them with channels. So they will interact with each other, not using locks, but passing each other values through channels. Now, channels come in multiple flavors. So depending on the buffering, how much buffering is in the channel, goroutines can execute concurrently. Or if your channel has buffering of zero, essentially there is no to buffer, then the channel will act as a rendezvous point. So essentially, a goroutine, when it tries to send into a channel and there is nobody trying to read from it, it will get suspended. And then when finally somebody starts reading from it, then this guy will give it a value, and they will go on their merry ways. So here is my attempt of doing goroutines in C++ using this machinery. So, and this is an example where I would want to pass stuff by reference. So here I have some coroutine type, goroutine, and I will get two channels, left and right, and then I will infinitely will try to pull a value from the left channel, add a 1 to that value, and push it to the right channel. And let's create 100 million of them. Try that at Go. So what we're doing here, we're saying that, okay, we will create n plus 1 channels. It will be 100 million and 1. And then we'll launch 100 million goroutines, and we will give essentially the channels to the goroutines in this fashion. So we'll have a channel on the left, a channel on the right, and then between the coroutine there will be a common channel, right? It'll go something like that. Oops, back. Okay. So who would venture a guess what I will print here? Yes, yes, the answer is I will print 100 million. So what happens here, when I do a sync push, and I have to do a sync push because the main is not a coroutine, I will inject a value in the first channel, then the first coroutine gets activated, it reads the value, give it to the next one, and they will keep going. So. So this executes essentially about 30 nanoseconds per single chain. That's pretty good, because essentially what you have here, you have a coroutine being activated, reads the value, then pushes value into a different channel, gets suspended, another one gets resumed, etc. So and for comparison, I think the call to an empty function is about 2 nanoseconds. And this is just on a very rough compiler which didn't do yet any optimizations which are coroutine specific. So this is just an example of what else can you do with coroutines besides just generators and tasks. Yes?
Where are the coroutines actually running? So which one of
them? Oh, this is completely synchronous. So there's exactly one thread here.
So I'm just asking, is it during the sync push or the sync push?
Yes, the whole thing will start working when I push it, I think. I don't remember. I written that example a long time ago, but it works, surprisingly. I just tested it. So I think this is how it will work. So when this thing is constructed, every coroutine will start pulling from the left channel. And then the channel will remember that, oh, there is a coroutine waiting to read from me, but I have nothing to give to it. All right, and at this point, the very first channel will say, oh, I just got a value. Let me activate the next one. Yes?
So to be clear, when you do go routine go, each coroutine runs a little bit to get up to the await.
Yes, go launches the coroutine. And actually, I think the situation where it runs is actual slightly funnier. Because in a straightforward implementation, you would run out of stack immediately. Because you would say, hey, channel, here's a value. Channel says, fantastic, let me resume the coroutine. And then the coroutine gets resumed, it runs a little, it pushes the value, and then it calls another one. So eventually, I mean, the stack cannot sustain 100 million little, it cannot. So essentially, there is some scheduler that will probably get run somewhere here on pool that will let this unroll. But it works. I can show it down. Okay. I love this quote. It gives me a nice segue. Alex Stepanov also likes this quote about STL. So essentially, coroutines in C++ 17 as proposed, they have several complexity layers. The very first one is for everyone. And it will satisfy Pamela Seymour. Because essentially, as long as you're satisfied with your future, with your generator, that's all you need. You will just use await and yield, or with differently named ones, and then you wouldn't need anything else. But sometimes, you may be satisfied with your asynchronous library, but there is a new API which just came from the OS, which is not covered by Boost, ASA, or something like that. Then you can extend, you can teach await to operate on things that do not yet have proper wrappers. So this is the power level user. It's not very complicated. And finally, if you really want to go wild, you can dig even more, and you can create new coroutine types. So in the next few slides, I will quickly dip into the expert level. I will dump a lot of information, and then we'll pull back from it, and we'll go slowly. I just need to put some definitions up front. So get ready. So if we read paragraph 3 from the wording, it says that a coroutine needs a set of related types and functions to complete the definition of its semantic. So what happens is that a compiler talks, well, you know, it's a MCC, GCC, you know, Clang, or something like that. It uses two magic types to talk to the library. Library creates a coroutine trait, which explains the semantic to the compiler of what it needs to do about coroutine. And compiler helpfully gives the library a coroutine handle, which allows the library to resume, to destroy coroutine, and do a few other things with it. And of course, there is no concrete classes, there is no V tables. We have two new concepts which allow us to do this customization. So let's go behind the magic. Let's see what happens in this coroutine. So because it's stackless, the stuff that has to persist across suspend and resume lives elsewhere. And by default, if we have no optimizations and library did not supplied custom allocator, we will allocate it on the heap. And what coroutine frame will contain, it will contain locals and temporaries. It will contain formals, because formal parameters are usually passed on the stack. And if we're going to use those formals, as here, we are using them after suspend point, we have to get our own copy, because stack will be gone when the coroutine is resumed. Now, because we have to return something different for the coroutine than normally we do, the compiler will ask the library, hey, library, what do you want? Oh, I didn't mention that. The green part, coroutine promise, is what is a library supplied type that we will put on the coroutine frame through which compiler talks to the library. So essentially, before we suspend, we will ask the coroutine, hey, what my return type should be? And it will return, in this case, a future. Then when we reach the return statement, we will tell to the coroutine promise, hey, this is the result. Please communicate to whatever needs to be needs to know the result, the value that was returned. Now, those are suspend points in this program. And what is on the right is an expression that should satisfy a waitable requirement. And we will go into the details on slide 32. The coroutine promise supplied has to satisfy coroutine promise requirements. And to make slide even more busy, we give two more customization points to the library. Sometimes you would like to suspend before you enter coroutine body. And also you would like to suspend before exiting the coroutine body. And the library gets to say whether it wants to do so or not. So this is an informal explanation of the transformation that compiler is doing. So when I see return expression, I will call promise return value and go to end of the function. If I see yield, I will call yield value and suspend. If I see await expression, we'll talk about that on slide 32. And when I need to figure out my return object, I will ask library about that. If an unhandled exception happens, library has a choice. If it provides set exception, it will stop an exception in that coroutine and then call promise set exception. So there, for example, you can go and call promise.setValue if you are using futures to transport that exception to whomever is waiting. And we have two points where we allow a library to say whether it wants to suspend or not. So this is a very brief intro about customization machinery. So now, in just three slides, I would like to show you how it actually works. So what is this? And Sean Parent, if he's in the audience, should not say a word. Yes, yes. And because the next slide will show a Fibonacci, I have to show the right way of doing Fibonacci before I jump to the less good way of doing it. So let's say I want to print first a bunch of Fibonacci numbers that are less than 10. And because I have no idea how big Fibonacci numbers are, I will ask for first 35 Fibonacci numbers. And I will implement it not in the best possible way. You know, it's not log n, it's O of n, but you know, it's still better than the recursive version. And to help show what happens, let's blow up the range base 4. So first thing which happens here, we'll call Fibonacci 35. We will enter the coroutine, and the coroutine frame will get created. Now, generator library implementation actually will demand suspension immediately. So after coroutine is created, we will not even go into the body of the function. Because maybe it will take, you know, several million years to get to the first value. As long as nobody will ask for it, why do that computation? So what happens here is that we create the coroutine frame, and we will create some room, at least logically, for A, B, next, and N. We will create a library glue that defines the semantic of the coroutine. And the only thing that coroutine promise would have in this case is just an int current value. It doesn't need anything else. Then we return. And coroutine promise will return me a generator. The only thing it has, essentially, it has a pointer back to the coroutine frame. So we are here. So now we start pulling. We get an iterator. And So first we are doing begin. Begin will resume the coroutine. It will start going from here until it hits the yield value. We will call yield value on the promise that will assign it here, after which we suspend the coroutine, and begin will return us an iterator pointing to the same coroutine. Then we will check right here whether we are done and we are not done, and there is a way to ask from a coroutine, are you done or not? And it's not, because we still have a lot of ways to go. Dereference will reach into the promise, we'll extract the value, we will get it here, we will print, and we will keep going. Plus plus will resume the coroutine again. So this is a top level view of the coroutine. Any questions at this point? Okay, let's dig deeper. Let's see what happens underneath of all that. So here I have a call to Fibonacci, which looks like this in the pseudo code before. But actually, this is what happens by the compiler. If you return a class type with non-trivial destructor, and there are some other rules, you would actually have the return value be on the stack of the caller, and it will be just raw memory, it's not initialized then. Then the pointer to that raw value will get passed as the hidden parameter to your function. And that's normal, that happens to normal functions, it's not specific to a coroutine. So essentially, what we have on the stack right now is a return value from main, which goes to whomever call main. And this is a range, because a range, the only thing it contains inside, essentially, is a pointer to a coroutine frame, so it nicely fit 8 bytes here. And then the ABI requires for us to have 4 shadow slots for use by the guy we call. So what we do a normal absolutely call, so we'll assign our CX that will have our hidden parameter. We will assign the address of range. We will set in RDX 35. And then we will do a call. So here we will have a return to main. Now we enter prologue of the function. And for some reason, compiler decided that it will enregister N, A, and B into those non-volatile registers, RDI, RSI, RBX. And also, it is going to use RBP as a frame pointer for a function. But unlike a normal function, the frame pointer will not point back to the stack. It will point to that coroutine frame that we showed, but it will appear in just a few seconds. Now, because we are using non-volatile register, calling convention requires us to save them on behalf of the caller. Caller doesn't expect those registers to change. So we'll just go and save the register. And just for fun, we will save the thing that we need to return later. And we push the stack pointer. So far, this is a normal function call. Then we allocate a coroutine frame. We have the coroutine promise that we looked at before. And it will have 4 more words here to save the values of the registers that we are using, plus an instruction pointer slot to remember the position at which we got suspended. So then the function goes, keeps running, and then at some point we suspend. What are we doing? Well, we will go and save A and B into the coroutine frame. We will remember the next instruction pointer that we need to jump to, and, well, another part of the ABI convention that even though that the caller knows that the range where range is, we still need to return it in RAX. And we restore the registers that we had, and we are done. So essentially, it looks like a normal function call, with the only exception that we have an extra storage for local and temporaries, which is on the side. And again, this is just one of the implementation possible. Yes?
There was one more local variable next.
Yes?
That's not saved, or it doesn't have to be saved?
Let me see. I think it doesn't have to be saved.
OK. because we haven't reached there?
Maybe it sits on top of something. Or actually, I know why next is not here, because it doesn't have to persist across the spans or something like that. I compiled, it didn't, somehow didn't need it. So it didn't put it into a frame. So then we return a generator on the span that will point to that coroutine frame. Now, what happens on resume? Let's say we're doing plus plus begin. Let's quickly zoom in to see what an iterator looks like. And it looks something like that. There is a coroutine handle, a magic type that compiler provides, which is just a void star with some syntactic sugar on top in form of the function calls that it provides. And what we will do in an iterator, we will just say, resume the coroutine and return this. So when we do the resume, what will happen is we will set the first parameter when we do this call to a coroutine frame. We do a call. We pushed the return address on the stack. We saved our RP, and whatever other registers we are using, we saved them too. It's just stack pointer and restored N, A, B, and keep going. So this essentially, this is how coroutines work at the low level. They don't have any expensive context switches. And depending on whether actually you decide to unregister or not those variables, you might get a better performance. For example, if we always have the variables not in registers but in the stack, we don't have to save the non-volatile registers here. So it saves a few instructions. OK. Yes, we have to jump to that address. So now I'm going to show how to adapt, how library writers can adapt coroutines to new things you can await upon. Before I go there, are there any questions? Yes?
Would it be useful sometimes to compile coroutines to use fewer registers to the
user? Absolutely. Absolutely. So I think heuristic in the compiler that decide when to use non-volatile register or not would need to be different in the coroutine than in a normal function. The question was, would it sometimes make sense not to use non-volatile register? The answer is absolutely. Just a second. What does it say?
30 minutes.
Oh, lovely. We have plenty of time.
Question?
Yes?
So far, the example showed coroutine being called from the same place.
Yes.
Not saved as an object and returned out of the call stack and called from somewhere else.
Yes. Well, a generator is movable. And what generator has inside, a single pointer value that you can just simply move around.
So this function can just return a generator out?
It can return a generator out, and then somebody else can consume it. But when you start moving generator, some optimizations might not be possible. For example, if compiler knows that the lifetime of coroutine is fully contained in the lifetime of the coding function, it doesn't have to heap allocate at all. It can just stick the coroutine frame right as the local variable on the caller, and then we are golden. If you start moving out, the comment was thank you. You are welcome. Yes?
Can we go over one more time what happens when you destroy the generator if you haven't pulled all the stuff out? Does it run the rest of the function?
No. The question is, can you tell exactly what happens when you destroy a generator? So I don't have an animation for that. But essentially what happens is that for every suspend point, compiler knows what set of destructors it needs to run if it ever has to go away. And coroutine handle, which we'll look at about 10 slides in the future, have two member functions, resume and destroy. When you call resume, it goes to the current suspend point and keep going. When you call destroy, it will go to the, not go, but is mentally, it goes to that resume point and runs the set of destructors.
Okay.
Without using exceptions, unlike other coroutines out there. OK. So awaitable. Awaitable is acts like range base 4, in the sense that it needs to find three functions to understand what to do with the expression. So range base 4 looks for begin and end. And first, if an expression is of a class type, it will go inside of that class type and see if there is a begin or end there. If it doesn't find them in that class, then it will try ADL lookup in the associative namespaces and will not do normal lookup at all. So that's exactly what happens with await. So when I see await expression, I will start looking for functions called await ready, await suspend, and await resume in the scope of the class. And if I don't find, I will start looking for standalone functions. So this is an equivalent of what this await expression expands to. But for readability, I will show it as the block as opposed to the question marks, you know, ternary expressions. So I would need to refer to the expression three times. That's why I give it a name. First, I will check whatever I have to await. Is it already done? Is the value already available? And if so, I will just say, please unpack the value. So the result of the await expression is whatever await resume returns. Now, if it is not ready, compiler will give a coroutine handle to the await suspend and says, please, await suspend, figure out a way to tell me when you are done. And here is the function object to call. Coroutine handle also acts as a function object if your interface desires so. And after that point, it suspends. When sometime later, somebody using this coroutine handle will call resume, it will jump right here and continue. And if it didn't find member functions, it will do the same with standalone functions. Now, let's see what we can do with that. Let's say, what if we await on this class? And as not to give you a hint, I put a blank so that so what will happen if I await on this? Yeah, essentially this is unconditional suspend. If you await on that, your coroutine immediately suspends. And unless you stashed away coroutine handle elsewhere, you will never be able to resume. And this guy, suspend never. Well, sorry, So if you suspend on this guy, well, if you await on this type, if you await on an expression of this type, it will be a no-op. Nothing will happen. Let's do something more complicated. Let's say I want to do something here, and I need a lock to do it. But I don't want to block the current thread while waiting for the lock. So let's design an awaitable that we'll call lock or suspend that essentially will do exactly that. If you're able to wait, so if you're able to lock immediately, then you will just keep going. Otherwise, you will suspend this coroutine. So first, we need to have a unique lock inside of this. And there is a special constructor of the unique lock called try lock, which will try to lock it and put some flag that indicates whether the lock was successful or not. So in await already, we will just say return whatever, if we own lock or not. Now, if we own lock, we will simply move out the unique lock from the inside to the outside, and that will be the result of the expression. If we need to suspend, I will do something horrible. And but, you know, it'll work, but I would not recommend to use it in production. Essentially, I will launch a different thread, and I give this callback that compiler gave me, helpfully. And in that thread, I will I will actually go in a blocking fashion, lock that lock, and then call the callback. After that, I will let the thread roams free, to roam free. So, I mean, do not use it, it's for illustration only, but if you had a better look that is not blocking but can inform you, you know, it could be written much better. Okay, let's make boost future awaitable. This example almost works, so we need to do some tweaks in the boost future to do it, but it almost works. So in await ready, we will call future is ready. In await suspend, we will say t.then, here is the resume callback to call, and in await resume, we will call .get. Why it wouldn't work is that t.then currently returns us a future. And then it will be destroyed at this semicolon. And it will actually block. And I cannot see a way how to ask boost future or say, hey, don't do it. I have a better way to go. But so it almost works. But this is after boost future is tweaked to allow that. That's how it would look like. Yes?
These are written as free function as opposed to member functions of unique future.
Yes, the question was, those are not members of the unique future. And the answer is yes. In the case where you cannot modify the class, you can add them as a free function in the namespace from where that class is located. So that way to you can hook up with the libraries that you cannot change.
And add those as the parameters, because I see two parameters here for suspend. Everywhere you see
all right.
Unique future as the first parameter.
Yes. Because in the case of the of where the member functions, it's this, right? Okay, let's see how we interact with raw C APIs using awaitables. So far we talked about awaitable. Now let's talk a little bit about the coroutine handle. So it has resume, destroy, done, and it has a way. And again, library evolution group didn't go through that, so names probably would be much, much better than what I put here. The last two is what allows us to marshal coroutine handle as the void star across C API boundaries. And also, so that the coroutine handle can act as a function object, it has operator call, which is the same as the resume. So let's write sleep 4. We saw it on the first few slides. So now sleep 4 will be written to go directly to OS APIs without any futures or any other intermediate machinery. Moreover, when it compiles away after optimizer, essentially it's a straight normal C. You can write it any faster. So we need to say we need to remember how much time we want to sleep for. And await ready would be very simple. I will say, hey, if I have to sleep for zero or negative number of seconds or whatever ticks, I'm ready. Otherwise, I will get a coroutine handle. Before I was doing template F because I didn't want to go into the details, but now I know that compiler gives me a coroutine handle, and I can give that to the OS. I will create a timer, this is OS call, that requires a callback and a context to go with it. And in the callback right here, what I will do, I will extract the coroutine handle from the void star that OS gave me back, and I will resume it. The only thing left is to start the timer. So now, when I'm awaiting on the sleep 4, we will subscribe to an OS timer that will tick in that number of seconds. And when it does so, it will resume the coroutine. Await resume does nothing. And the structure would release the resources that were associated for the timer. Yes? So in Windows, this particular API, if you want a relative timer, it has to be negative. If you want absolute, it has to be positive. Just the way it is. OK, we talked about coroutine handle, awaitable, await. Now let's go for the hardcore. Let's see how we can create a coroutine type. So when compiler sees that, it instantiates this coroutine traits, and then it looks for the promise type inside that it will use to define the semantic of the coroutine. So let's define semantic for the coroutine that returns boost future. Okay, so we define the traits for boost future, and we don't care what the rest of parameters are. So, and we will put a promise into the boost future, because that's how future communicates, how you could communicate with the future by playing with the promise. Compiler will ask us, hey, I need to return something when I suspend. What do I return? Well, we will ask the future, give us the future. So that's what we will return. When you see the return statement in the coroutine, we need to give that value to the future. So compiler will call this guy, and library will say, sure, push it through a promise. If an exception happened, push the exception to the promise. And finally, I don't care about initial suspend point. I don't care about the final suspend point. So this is all which is needed to make to teach the compiler how to act with coroutines which return a unique future. Yes?
The suspend, the initial suspend and final suspend, couldn't those be more like properties of the function rather than of the...
There are use cases where which we found. Okay, the question is, well, can we just make that something like a type or some constant, right, that says, yes, I need initial suspend. Why do they have to be functions? Is this roughly the question?
I might want to use just one generator type, but maybe in my Fibonacci function, I want to suspend initially, or have there be a point where suspension can happen. There's another one where I need it to run immediately and then stop at the first await.
So the question is whether, depending on a function, I might want to have an initial suspend, and sometimes I don't want initial suspend, and should I let the function decide? Well, no and yes. No is that, no, it's the coroutine author which decides what is the semantic of the coroutine. And yes, because, you see, we actually pass all of the arguments. We specialize with all of the arguments. Therefore, if you want somehow to alter how the function behaves, you can, for example, add a tag parameter. And then you can supply a different machinery. So if we can somehow distinguish from the function signature that it is different from the general case, you can provide a different machinery for it. OK. And this is we're near the end. So I said that we can use coroutines without exceptions and still have a very sensible way of propagate errors. And this was to enable curl mode and people in Google JSF that do not have exceptions available, they can still use the coroutines and have the nice experience. So before we looked at the coroutine handle, but I didn't show you the primary template for it. So what coroutine handle is doing when it is, you know, the promise with which it associated, essentially it gives you a way to reach into a promise and do something to it. And right now, we are going to change our hookup to the unique future in such a manner that we will propagate an exception if it happened in the underlying future without throwing at all. So which function do you think we need to change? Is it this one? This one. It's okay. Who thinks it's two? Good. Who thinks it's one? Who thinks it's three? Okay, three. And one. So, we're good so far, right? Everything on this slide is clear. When we do await suspend, we will just give them the callback that we gave, and when the future completes, it will call it. Okay. Well, actually now we know that compiler doesn't give us just a functional object. It doesn't give us a coroutine handle of void. It actually gives us a coroutine handle of that with that exact promise of the enclosing function. So what we can do here, we can check whether the result has an exception. And if so, we will go and set it directly into the promise. After that, we don't want to resume the coroutine normally. We want to kill it. And we will call destroy. Otherwise, we will resume the coroutine normally. This has one bug. We need to change one more line to make it work for all cases. And what is broken here, what is future is already ready, but it completed with an exception. Well, then we'll go to .get and we'll throw. So the last thing we need to tweak is this. In case the future is ready, but it has an exception, we want to send it on a slow path that we'll throw here. Sorry, not throw, but propagate the error back to the guy who is awaiting for the completion of the coroutine. And essentially what we have a very nice, clean-looking code that looks as if we're using exceptions, but if we don't have, but we are not. Because essentially at every point here, there is an if error go to end embedded. And this actually can be used with expected. Now there is no asynchrony involved at all. But some companies are interested in this particular use of the coroutines. So in more general form, this is what happens, is that a coroutine returns some kind of container which contains the value inside of it. And then it allows you to operate easily on other things which returns values wrapped in some kind of containers. It allows us to unpack the value, and if there is any problem, it will propagate back into this thing. And so you can use with futures, options, expected, and still future. Now, to make it more efficient and not force compiler to go through some heroic efforts, there need to be some addition to the proposals. And some people are interested in that, and that will be submitted as a separate proposal. So another thing which can happen in the future is that we can actually have const expert generators. Right now, we ban coroutines and const expert. But you know, if we had them, not necessarily with the syntax, you could just initialize your aggregates at constant time with some computed values. And let's see what I have. Oh, as I promised, in the end, we will talk about keywords. And we will do it ophthalmologist style. You will tell me A or B, A or B, and then we'll go B or C. So, A or B? A or B? Okay. Okay, now please, who wants B? Okay, that's fine. Now, for those who wants B, okay, good. Okay, excellent. Now, for you, and you, and you, and you, four people, B or C? B, sorry, A. B or C? Okay. So essentially, I think right now in the wording, it's this one with co yield, co await. But then there were. Yes. What? Okay, those are placeholders. We will still debate the better names. So, okay, so it's. Yes. Please, yes.
Can we go back to slide 8 just so I can make my impassioned plea for BLC? For the rest of the room that were so convinced.
Sure.
If we take a look at the, these are all returning features, not generators.
Well, this guy returns a generator.
Okay. He's not using return. It's the confusing return becoming co-return was the very specific thing that pushes me towards B and C. So you've not shown the actual really motivating example.
I'm going by aesthetics. Okay. There was a comment that
back to slide 17.
Yes. So there was a comment that, if you remember, in the beginning of the talk, in one of the very first slides, we had about three or four people asking questions about, hey, look, return and yield. I mean, what's going on? So, absolutely, there is this confusion initially.
So why was just that change? Just make it coroutine and everything else is fine.
The same point I was going to make.
Yeah, right. Rest of them look fine.
If return is going to be a point of confusion,
just make it coroutine.
Fix return, but await and yield are exactly what.
Okay, so since we started on this path, and I will. I'm sorry, what does it say there?
Say that if all of you people who want yield, can you not imagine a variable named yield, particularly in financial software?
Well, so the comment was saying just part of what I will say now. Why yield is problematic, unless it's context sensitive in some way, is that, you know, nukes? They actually use yields as like dial a yield. So in physics, doing the blow up stuff, they use yield as a domain term. Agriculture uses yield as a domain term. Finance uses yield as a domain term. Automotive, you know, cars now drive themselves. So.
Your tone is also a financial tone.
So the comment was that return is already a financial term, but we already have the return keyword.
So you have no variables named return.
And essentially, the comment is that if we go with coreturn and yield is problematic, well, we can also, for consistency, name everything else co-yield, co-return, co-await, etc. Well, there are about 10 languages which use await with return with this syntax, and they. But that's. I will go no more. I don't want to advocate for anything. I am just impartial, you know, deliverer of the information. Let's see. Yes, please. What's your comment?
So, regardless of how you spell the new keyword, was there any discussion of the fact that, like, none of these are in the standard namespace, none of these are in the implementation namespace. Like, they're, no matter what identifier you pick, it's an identifier that someone is already using for variables and functions. Like, was there no discussion of, like, std colon colon await or underscore?
So the question is, could we just use, like, keywords prefixed by the std namespace? That would be a precedent about key. No, I think that we did not spend a lot of time talking about the keywords. Essentially, when the initial set of keywords we used for the previous 3 years of talking of coroutines were found problematic, we had a brief brainstorming, you know, bike shedding, and some names were thrown on the floor, but we did not actually go and did the study of the alternative. So those are just quick fixes that we did. Yes? So the comment is, on some POSIXes, yield as a function. Yes, that's why yield by itself as the keyword may have some issues.
Can it be context-sensitive?
Okay. Question was, can it be context-sensitive? Yes, and that's how most of the other languages resolve that. Essentially, if you noticed in my first slide, nearly every other language puts some kind of tag before the function. You know, async, function star, sync star, there are various flavors. But that way, they're free to use await and yield as context sensitive.
Just surround them with braces or something.
Demon.
By another standard such as POSIX,
the word you're using is a macro. It's just not, you cannot do something that breaks all most POSIX programs. You just, it's not, no one on the committee, you're never going to get consensus to break billions of lines of code.
Absolutely. The comment is, you will never be able to use keyword as not context sensitive, yield as non-context sensitive keywords, because there are so many domains where it is, you know, a domain specific name. And we have POSIX with markers which has the word yield in them. So yield is troublesome. So my view there is I think we need to distinguish between two things. One is there some ideal set of keywords we would be happy if there are no constraints? That's step number one. Is it possible to get those nice, pretty keywords in some way by going through some trouble in the compiler? You know, maybe it's context sensitive. Maybe. And if we cannot do that, then we have to have a fallback plan, some reasonable, you know, keywords which will fall back if we cannot use context-sensitive keywords. The comment was, how about we'll stick double underscores? Okay. So I'm at the end. So we're done. And we're right on time. Yes, please.
I just have a really basic question here. I mean, this is going to, for example, the range algorithm example. This is a very interesting way to write the algorithm. It makes the algorithm easier to write in some sense. But I'm trying to figure out, since the calling code, this is
the calling code.
Right.
Yep.
But the calling code, what happens there when the calling code stops, the coroutine starts, and the coroutine stops, the calling code resumes, right? So where does the advantage work here? What's the point? What's the fundamental point?
I don't think I understand. I understand part of the question. So why? Okay.
Why?
So the question: why would we use a coroutine?
Yes.
Because in some cases it is easier to write the state machine, expressed as the flow, as the control flow, as opposed to crafting the coroutine itself. As handcrafting the state machine itself. So this example here is slightly shorter than example that Eric showed.
Yes.
Now, this has some limitations, right? It's input iterator. And when you are handcrafting the machine, you can make it forward if you want to. So there is a cost to that. But there are cases where it is OK. And if it's simpler, more debuggable, possibly, you can step through, you know, see how it is doing. Well, generator, I think we can get to nearly zero overhead compared with what other things are doing in certain scenarios. As long as you're not moving around the coroutine itself, we can avoid any heap allocations. With async patterns, and I'm not showing it in this presentation, but I can show it in other ones about coroutines, is that async coroutines are actually negative overhead abstraction. You can do better than most handcrafted state machine can do. So for async, it's a clear win. For generators, it's comparable, sometimes slower, but easier to write, sometimes.
Can we go back to the slide?
Sure.
I was basically answering Alan, I think. Or you can tell me if I'm misunderstanding. Back to the caller side?
Yep.
Two or three slides? There we go. So we've got, where's the for loop on here? For auto interleave key. So either interleave is going to have to pre-populate a vector dynamically on the heap with all the results in one hit, consuming all the resources at one time, and then return you all the resources in one big hit. So assume returning a million ranges rather than three. We're going to have to dynamically allocate space for a million ranges. If we run this through a coroutine, we're only allocating one rank at a time because we're jumping backwards and forwards. So the actual resource consumption at any given time in the program is much lower.
Yes, if you're trying to do interleave in a normal procedural fashion and return a vector, it will be expensive. But here I was trying to compare coroutines to range adapters, which also provide the same abstraction. And then, essentially, it is potentially lazily produced, and it's a lazily produced, potentially infinite sequence. So both range adapters and coroutine generators are providing this particular service. Let's see.
It's more like a remark. I attended the talk about ranges, and someone raised the point that it would lead to code which is very difficult to debug because it would be, you know, full of states. And if a debugger can follow the resume calls, then we would get back the debuggability.
So the comment is that during Eric's presentation on ranges, there was a concern raised about difficulty to debug. And this could be easier. Yes and no. Yes, because if what you have is a single generator coroutine, it will be easier. But now let's put it into the pipeline with multiple, say, range adapters. They all smooshed together in one big, huge, essentially a range adapter, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, until you hit the coroutine, you have all of the debugging concerns you had before. If it is in line in some way, optimizers can do weird stuff. So in debug mode, definitely easier. Alan.
To rephrase my question, coroutines are orthogonal to concurrency. Yes.
So you can use coroutines in both synchronous. Oh yeah, the question was, coroutines are orthogonal to concurrency. And the answer is yes, but they're helpful in concurrent scenarios. Let's go here.
Yeah. One of the reasons why I'm excited about this is because it makes continuation style programming, as Sean showed in his previous talk, way, way easier, right? You don't have to turn your algorithm kind of upside down, but you write it in the natural way. That's very, very exciting.
The comment is that coroutine applied to asynchronous programming is a very exciting thing because it can make the code that used to be written using continuations could be now expressed in nearly normal fashion and makes it easier to read. Yes? Same true for easier code. Yes, it will make easier code easier to read. Right now, to hook up coroutines with Azure, we need to use underscore future adapter that that Chris Kochloff provided, but that is not very efficient. So if there will be another one called use await, where it will, instead of returning us a future, it will return an awaitable class, kind of what I showed before, then suddenly we will become zero overhead. Let's go here. That's a wonderful idea. I think initially we tried do dot and possibly, please, my name is my email address is gor nishanov@microsoft.com. send me your suggestions, everybody. We will see. Okay, let's go over there. When you first enter the coroutine, we will allocate memory dynamically unless we can elide it. And we cannot always elide that allocation.
Can you explain a bit more about how you go about eliding?
Sure. So here, compiler knows that coroutine will be destroyed, well, when this block ends, right? Because the generator, like in its destructor, it calls coroutine.destroy, and it's a magic type. So now compiler sees that, oh, okay, coroutine was destroyed here, and there was no like move operations which moved the handle elsewhere. So therefore, I can actually put the coroutine frame right here and elide allocation whatsoever.
Okay, I'll talk to you after, because I now have an optimization for you, which is achievable, but I'll talk to you after.
Another optimization immediately there will eliminate the potentially indirect call. When you call cororesume, right, here we know exactly what we are calling, right? We are calling the whatever is the resume part of the interleave. So we just replace to the direct call here. And as soon as we did that, suddenly we can inline that part of the coroutine in the body of the function. So there are various optimizations which are possible.
I was thinking actually that you pass the traits that say which type to be constructed return as the return transport type. If you're able to put through the information that this is something that's going to be destroyed shortly and it's not returned to traverse a thread boundary, then you can return a different type in future which always allocates memory and thereby make it even more efficient again.
Okay, the comment was that we can be smarter, for example, if we're using futures, how we allocate memory. And roughly, I'm paraphrasing. And the answer is yes. And one of the things that HPX folks want to do is to combine an allocation of the shared part of the HPX future with the coroutine frame. And that is possible. We need to just see if we need to tweak the machinery a little bit or not. Eric.
I'm very excited about this work. I think it dovetails really nicely with the range work, and I think it makes it much, much easier to write things that have a range interface. I would love it if these things were forward iterable. That is, if you copied them, it preserved the state of the coroutine.
Okay, the comment from Eric is that it is awesome thing, it nicely dovetails with ranges, but it would be even better if we could make coroutines forward iterable. So let me show you what makes it very, very difficult. So let's look at this coroutine. What is the state of the coroutine? It has this vector, right? And it has here an iterator pointing inside of that vector. Let's try to define a copy constructor for a coroutine. So for vector, it's easy. We'll copy entire vector. But how do compiler figure out how to copy an iterator so that it will point at the copied vector? So this is, I don't know how to do it cheaply. I know how to do it in an expensive fashion. I just remember how far do I need to go. I will just start from the beginning. But even rewind for the coroutine is expensive because I am modifying potentially the parameters. And parameters are in the coroutine frame. So if I want to make coroutines rewindable, I need to copy also and preserve the original values of all parameters passed. Then I will be able to go back and replay the coroutine from the beginning. So essentially, forward iterators are complicated. I'm not sure if we can get them. Maybe we will. But right now, it's input iterables. Yes?
So are the coroutines copy constructible to save an old state? Or?
OK, so question is, are coroutines copy constructible to save state? So the word coroutine is unfortunately overloaded, even in this talk. Because sometimes I am talking about the function itself. And sometimes I am talking about the return type, which is used like generator style. So if we're saying the generator, that type which is being returned, it is a coroutine, then absolutely, you can define copy constructor, you can do whatever you want. But it will be probably unwise to copy construct, to copy the generator, because now you have two guys trying to resume the same coroutine. And if they're doing it from different threads, it would be a bad idea. So I think the generator that we will propose to the standard library, it will be move constructible, because it's safe. And you cannot get yourself into trouble. Hooray, we're done.